traveling because we're expecting more people, and soon there may not be a seat available. Helena, there are three here, two over there, a couple sprinkled throughout. We're going to get a couple more chairs out. I'm going to get us started on time today. Good afternoon. I'm Lori Lima, Faculty Senate President. And on behalf of the Faculty Senate, I'd like to welcome you to the DVC Faculty Senate 51st Annual Faculty Lecture. Yay! 51 years, great time. Just to let you know, the Faculty Lecture is selected by the Faculty Senate Council. And the criteria for selection of the lecturer each year is based upon that person's submission of a broad intellectual topic of interest to the college community, and in addition to that, that person's leadership contributions to the college. This year, as you already know, our faculty lecturer is Professor Marcia Goodman, an English instructor here at DVC. Let me give you a little bit of background about Marcia. Professor Goodman earned her BA in English from State University of New York at Stony Brook, her MA in English from UC Berkeley, and also from UC Berkeley, her PhD in English Literature. In the early and mid parts of Marcia's 20 years at DVC, she was very involved in activities across the campus, and quite a range of them. I'm only going to highlight just a few. She was a representative for the English Division on the Faculty Senate Council. She served on the accreditation standards. She was the UF, which stands for Our United Faculty, which is our faculty bargaining agent. She served on the executive board member. She was a chief negotiator, not an easy task. And she also was editor for Table Talk, which is the UF publication. In the second part of her career, she focused on English department activities. She has been the department chair in English, a very large department, for two terms. She has been active in the Literature Week contests and activities, has been a lead on program review for the English area, has been involved in many faculty hiring, screening, and interview committees, and has participated in the Nexus program as a mentor for our new faculty. She's also been involved in a host of other activities, committees, and professional commitments, including an Emeritus College lecture on Dickens' novel, Our Mutual Friend, many talks at conferences on composition and teaching community college students, and has produced a series of publications primarily focusing on types of essays and poems. In today's presentation, Professor Goodman will share with you that she's been living with an advanced cancer since 1998 while continuing to teach English here at DVC. In her faculty lecture, she will talk about some of what it has been like in terms of your experiences and what she's learned during her almost 17 years navigating life with this disease, and especially with regard to her work with her students. She will also talk about the realities of living with cancer. Professor Goodman gave this same presentation you're going to hear last night, and I wanted to share with you personally that I found it very powerful and moving, and it gave me a lot to think about. Marcia is truly an amazing person with profound insights. She models courage and resiliency and is the consummate professional. She is truly a gift to the DVC community. It is my pleasure and my honor to introduce the DVC 2015 Faculty Lecturer, Professor Goodman.
To live up to that. everybody hear me back there?
Yes.
Some of you are standing. There are a few seats. I promise I won't call on you if you sit in the back. Relax. Good time. It's harder to sneak out. The title of my talk is The Strength of Fragility, but I start with, you'll see I talk about failure a lot before I get to strength. So don't worry, we will get to the strength. Don't get nervous. Today I want to talk about living with advanced cancer, how that has conditioned and influenced my beliefs about teaching and learning, and how it has shaped my sense of a meaningful life. I want to say up front that my observation of myself and of others who are living with an advanced cancer is that we all do it differently, and there is no right way or healthier way to live it out. We each do cancer as we do life, bringing to it all the individual strengths, weaknesses, quirks, and neuroses that we bring to everything else we do. Our family backgrounds with their particular emotional terrain developed early, and the nature of our individual psychologies shape each of our individual encounters with this disease. There are areas of overlap and similarities, of course, but I think by and large, we in the cancer community all do it our own way. And like so much else in life, there are no right answers. For me, living with an advanced ovarian cancer since I was 43, I'm 60 now, has meant shifting the metaphors I use to describe my experience, realigning some of my priorities in my personal and professional life, and reshaping my sense of myself in the world. I didn't make any radical changes. From the outside, I think I've looked pretty much the same. But inside, I've undergone, over time, a slow, steady revolution. How much of this would have happened to me anyway as I've aged, I'll never know. I came from a home that was very troubled, always on the edge of falling apart, and filled with emotional and often physical violence. We lived in a small flat in a dense neighborhood of Brooklyn, and the four of us were tightly enmeshed in each other's emotional lives. I was the good kid. My brother, 2 years older, was the bad kid. There were many reasons for these extreme roles, but they were fixed early on. My brother's life ended tragically when he was 30 in a police siege around my parents' home. It never became clear whether he had killed himself or whether the police had fired their own rifles first. I tell you this to let you know that when my cancer diagnosis came, I had plenty of past trauma already within me as a psychological blueprint. This helped me and it hurt me. I did not go to anger and outrage at the universe, did not dwell on a sense of injustice. I was tremendously sad, sadder than I thought imaginable, mostly at the thought of leaving my husband and my children. But I had learned long ago in my family of origin, living amidst emotional chaos, how to be resilient and persistent. And so I was able to put my head down and keep walking. What I did feel, in addition to the heartbreaking sadness, was tremendous guilt and responsibility. In those early cancer years, I kept trying to muster the outrage that others felt or that seemed it might be healthier to feel. Then, ultimately, I accepted how I was dealing with it and made peace with my own way of encountering this new turn my life had taken. When I was diagnosed with advanced ovarian cancer in October 1998, I also initially felt shock, that kind of shock you feel when your world turns upside down, when the realities you consider to be true turn out not to be, and you have to redefine who you are in relation to the world around you. It was perhaps the first time in my life when I consciously, anyway, underwent an out-and-out identity crisis. The things that English majors love to talk about. After I came back from 3.5 weeks in the hospital and was finally able to be up and around on my own, I'd stand in front of the mirror in our bathroom and school myself. "You have cancer," I'd tell my own image. I'd instruct myself, "Say it, say the word, cancer, 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 you have cancer." I was trying to demystify the word, de-demonize it, make it less terrifying. But I was also trying to relearn who I was now that I was a person with an advanced disease. Of course, my identity crisis came with other very real crises too. The physical shock to my body of long, difficult surgeries and intense chemotherapies. The emotional shock to my family, especially to my husband and still young children, my daughter only 11, my son 8. To my parents who had already lost their only other child, to my stepsons who'd already seen upheaval in their lives, and to all others who loved me. And then there were the practical crises of work, money, taking care of the household. As I've said, growing up, my brother and I divided the roles in our troubled family. And I, the younger by 2 years, got the part of good, successful child. I was one of those kids who thought they could hold the family and the world together for at least one more day if they just did everything right. The essayist Scott Russell Sanders explains his version of this effort. In his case, he tried to be perfect in order to offset his childhood guilt about his father's alcoholism. He writes, "I tell myself he drinks to ease an ache that gnaws at this belly, an ache I must have caused by disappointing him somehow, a murderous ache I should be able to relieve by doing all my chores, earning A's in school, winning baseball games, fixing the broken washer and the burst pipes, bringing in money to fill his empty wallet. If only I were perfect." My father was not an alcoholic, though my brother turned out to become one. But Russell Sanders described so well my own sense of urgency as a kid to do everything right. So I was a super student, a good athlete, a school leader, and the kid who was almost always respectful, except when I wasn't. I did have my moments. And I remember being in seventh grade and getting my first B+. Unbelievable, but it's true. It was on an English speech, and I'd chosen something very difficult to talk about. I ran home from school and into the bathroom sobbing, slamming the door behind me. I knew it was crazy to cry over a B+, but I didn't then know why it meant so much to me, getting an A. It wasn't until I was in college that I started to understand myself better. In seventh grade, I only felt that I had done something terrible, that awful things would happen to my family because I hadn't gotten the highest grade. I did recover from the B+, my way being to work harder so it wouldn't happen again. But years and years later, lying in the hospital after 2 major abdominal surgeries, fearing I'd never make it home, worrying about my family, I felt like I'd become my brother. My brother, 2 years older than I, would have loved to get a B+. He was my shadow self, and I his. He never did any homework, hardly showed up to class, stole, got into fights, was often in detention or suspension. Here I was, a major failure, failing my husband, my children, my parents, my friends, my students, my colleagues. I was in the fourth year of my work at DVC and so right on the edge of getting tenure. At one level, I worried that now I wouldn't get it, that I'd be punished for my absence. On another less conscious level, I worried that now I didn't deserve it. Practically, I worried about how I would continue to be an energetic, committed teacher and colleague when I had a major illness to deal with, one likely to end my life too soon. I flashed images of my brother 15 years before, dead in a police siege at age 30. Confession of hubris. I have been one of those people who assumed I'd live to be 107. Now I knew I'd be extraordinarily lucky to see 50. I don't know how I originally came up with the number 107. Perhaps it was some combination of anecdotal evidence, seeing that my four grandparents had lived into their late 80s and 90s. Belief in my generation's myth that we could change everything at will, including the body's frailty. Buying into the idea of science as all-powerful. And just plain denial of the body's fragility, a sometimes arbitrary fragility, which is ultimately, as Atul Gawande so elegantly tells us in his book, On Mortality, a refusal to know finiteness until one absolutely has to. Gawande quotes Sally, a hospice nurse. I'd say only about a quarter of patients have accepted their fate when they come into hospice. 99% understand they're dying, but 100% hope they are not. They still want to beat their disease. One of Gawande's points in his book is that recognizing finitude helps one straighten out one's priorities, and that there are priorities beyond prolonging life. Gawande ends his book with the story of his own father's death. Part of the way my father handled the limits he faced was by looking at them without illusion. Though his circumstances sometimes got him down, he never pretended they were better than they were. He always understood that life is short and one's place in the world is small, but he also saw himself as a link in a chain of history. But at first, I experienced my body's limits and finitude as failure. Shouldn't I, the mother of two young children, be able to conquer this? I felt I'd let down my family. After all, part of my belief that I'd live to be 107 was a fiction created for my children, a way to assure myself and them that I'd always be around to help and take care of them. I got through the first 5 years and, victim to another myth, thought this meant I was cured. Five years, I soon learned, is just an average. It meant that a chunk of people with my diagnosis would not die of the disease after that, but it didn't guarantee anything. In 2003, a week or two after the five-year mark, I was diagnosed with a recurrence, and once again, I was given very bad odds of survival. I did the requisite surgeries and a year of chemotherapy, and remembered once again, strangely I'd almost forgotten, that I was mortal after all, and this disease stronger than I. And then, to the astonishment of myself, my doctors, my family, I went another 5 years without a recurrence. And again, I began to forget. Then in 2008, I recurred again, and 6 months later again, and in 2011, needed yet another major surgery. It became clear that I would need to spend the rest of my life on one treatment or another. On a lighter note, it became clear to me that I would now always be the woman in the hat. My hair having mostly given up, not venturing to take a try anymore to come back, during my very short vacations from treatment. And those of you who know me or seen me around campus know that I have 1,000 hats. I am lucky in that my particular form of ovarian cancer is very chemotherapy sensitive. It responds well to treatment. On the other hand, I'm unlucky in that it's very persistent. It will always come back. As time goes on, it will come back more and more quickly and eventually wear out its response to any particular treatment. And so I am dependent on the creation of new drugs. When it finally became clear to me that this was my reality, that there would be no more believing that I would ever live what seemed a more normal life, I lost my ability to pretend that somehow I could win this particular battle. Just as with each five-year survival period, I'd begun once again to feel hubris, a sense of my victory over this disease, only to be reminded that there could be no such thing. Also, with each long period of remission, I had regained a sense of my identity as one who succeeds. In 2008, however, and the few years following, it became absolutely clear to me that there would be no winning this battle, unless I redefined victory as just surviving, being continuously on treatment, and that didn't seem like much. Even more than before, I had to redefine how I saw myself in the world, and more importantly, how I saw myself within myself. That is, who I was to myself. This is when I think I finally let go of the battle metaphor, one that I had used but had had trouble with from the start. It is a tempting metaphor, the battle metaphor. We are raised on competition. In the working class Brooklyn neighborhood where I grew up, it was a way of life, perhaps because so much there was a struggle. And though I had an easier time than some kids I went to school with, since my folks were college educated, competition still felt the ticket to leaving that world for an easier one, or at least one with more options, and one with, I hoped, more beauty and more peace. And my father in particular fostered competitiveness and ambition in our home, perhaps because he himself had not become what he'd wanted to, had not achieved his goals. He had an excessive reverence for those who seemed as if they had achieved them, or who seemed as if they would. Competition became a terribly unhealthy force between my brother and myself. He was 2 years older, but just could not compete with me in school, which made up most of our world then. My father was a teacher and then school administrator. My mother worked in the accounting office of a community college. And education meant everything in our family. So when I was first diagnosed and everyone told me I would somehow beat this disease, I appreciated their confidence in me and their optimism, but something felt very uneasy within me. "You're a fighter," they said, "and you're so strong, you will win." I wanted to believe them and this voice in myself as well, but win? Am I in a battle, I thought, and I felt an uneasy combination of guilt and fear. And if I had to win now, had I lost before I'd even known I'd been fighting a war? Had I done something wrong, something so wrong I was being punished? Had I performed so badly without even knowing I'd been performing? And then there was the violence of the metaphor. The cancer, after all, was inside of me. Was I supposed to fight with myself? Was I my own worst enemy? And by now, I'd seen friends and acquaintances die too young of cancer, most notably my childhood friend Karen, who'd gotten breast cancer at age 28 and died at 33, right, I might note, after her own five-year mark. Had she not fought hard enough? I knew Karen well. She was the child of terribly traumatized Holocaust death camp survivors and had had to create her own sense of optimism and joy. She'd done everything there was to do to survive cancer, including a bone marrow transplant in the earlier days when the risks were greater, flying to specialists all over the country, swimming every day, jogging, and eating every green vegetable on the planet. She'd written a memoir, volunteered at cancer organizations, and planned on adoption, all while she'd recovered from extremely draining and dangerous treatments. And yet, she had not made it. And then there was her beatific smile, a smile that would make you drop dead with happiness when you saw her coming down the street, a smile that she carried until the very late stages of her disease. The battle metaphor just did not apply. She'd fought as hard as anyone could have, and she'd lost. Did that make her a loser? A failure? Was she somehow responsible for her own too early death? So, although at bad moments I felt like a failure, and although I was being told I was a warrior, I knew deep in my heart that I was neither. I just knew that my body had broken down, that I was more limited than I'd thought, and that I'd have to find a new way of seeing myself, the whole of myself. I had proof I was not all-powerful, nor always able, and it turned out that I needed help to carry on, a lot of help. Truly, it has taken much support to help me survive as long as I have. The support of family, dear friends, colleagues, neighbors, and kind and expert medical professionals. Each time I had a recurrence, and especially in 2008 and its following years, when I realized I would never really be off treatment again, I felt like King Lear on the heath out in the storm. He has lost everything, been stripped bare of all his illusions of power and all his physical and mental energy. Almost in passing, he says, "I am not ague-proof," ague being the Elizabethan English word for flu. Yes, even kings get the flu if they're out in the storm, or even if they're not. And even people who have fantasies of being able to beat anything realize that they really are only, to use Lear's words, that poor, bare, forked creature out in the cold, if they are reduced to only the body's physical frailty. And I know I have many students in the audience who know this play really well. Now you know why I love it. So I needed a metaphor that would express my sense of identity now, no longer the victorious fighter who could beat all odds. Some have suggested the metaphor of a person on a journey, cancer the journey. I don't much relate to this idea either. After all, cancer is not a journey I would choose, and it's not clear where it leads, except probably to death, but all of life leads there eventually. More and more, I've come to resist metaphors that suggest a linear process or a culmination point. I am resting more and more in a simple sense of being, just being. Cancer as an ocean, maybe, I, the swimmer, trying to stay afloat. This doesn't mean I've completely given up ambition, but rather that I am more and more committed to the present. Gawande says that no matter the age of a person, once she has a sense of the finiteness of life, she lives differently. With the felt sense of an end, she becomes much more focused on the quality of the present, the richness of the activities and connections of the present moment, and the connection to other human beings and to a sense of meaning to be found there. This certainly has been my experience. It is not that I have entirely given up ambition, but my ambitions are much more modest and more contained than they used to be, with much shorter timelines. So instead of thinking to myself, "Oh yes, I will send that book of poems off at the end of this year," I think, maybe I can finish one halfway decent draft of a poem by the end of next week, if I'm lucky. I like the verb in Gawande's book's title. It's being mortal. That progressive use of the verb to be, that being, makes the process paramount. It's the being that counts, the aliveness in the present. This sense of being in the present moment is tied to my sense of limits and to my redefinition of myself as someone who has a great many limits, but who acts with strength within them. Just physically, for example, I am often tired, depending on the latest medical news, depressed, or anxious. I am less tolerant of noise, tumult, chaos, and sudden shifts in focus than I used to be. It's harder for me to walk long distances, harder to stand for long periods of time, and difficult to withstand colds, flus, viruses, any germs that may come wafting toward me. And then there's the nausea, never entirely under control, the nerve deadness in my hands and feet, and the headaches. But these physical limitations, a function really of the treatments more than the disease, are not for me the really hard thing. The really hard thing is the sense of standing in a different world from many around me, even from those I love most deeply. It's not the physical world I mean, but the emotional one, the internal one. Christopher Hitchens, writer of political essays and memoir, died in 2011 of esophageal cancer, a year and a half after his diagnosis. In the last year of his life, he wrote a memoir entitled Mortality. It's about his confrontation with his illness and his own coming death. In it, he tells us how his advanced cancer suddenly put him in a different emotional world from those around him. Here is Hitchens describing his first hospital experience as a cancer patient. I had the time to wonder why they needed so many boots and helmets and so much heavy backup equipment. But now that I view the scene in retrospect, I see it as a very gentle and firm deportation, taking me from the country of the well across the stark frontier that marks off the land of malady, the land of illness. And then explaining one feature of what sets his internal world apart. I am badly oppressed by the gnawing sense of waste. I had real plans for my next decade and felt I worked hard enough to earn it. Will I really not live to see my children married? For me, the sense of living in a different world was striking, one where illness, treatment, uncertainty, and death are common occurrences. For once you become part of the cancer community, sadly, many of your new friends and acquaintances die too young. And you, of course, always live under that hanging sword, the question, will this be the doctor's visit when she says there are no more treatments left? Residents in this new cancer country made me at first feel alienated, as if I'd become someone from another planet, a friendly, if lonely, Martian. Although I loved hearing the laughter of my friends at parties because of the sense of life going on, a great comfort, I also frequently felt out of it, alienated, like I just could not rise to the occasion. My lightness, such as it was, had receded. I got quieter, became even more of a listener. I became even more of a searcher and appreciator of what Virginia Woolf calls the real, or of the hidden life that Adrienne Rich implies in her lovely phrase, what is found there. Think about Mrs. Dalloway in Virginia Woolf's novel by that name, doing errands around London for her party that evening, in search of some essence, some true story beneath the surface of things, the surface of what people say to others. Woolf's character, Mrs. Dalloway, is aware, too aware, of all that is not said, all the feelings not articulated, but there nevertheless, consciously or unconsciously there, the internal life that flows that we don't usually name to each other. Literature in general is good at depicting this essential life that is both part of the surface of things and yet apart from it. Often trying to get to the realities beneath appearances, some essence of life that we all want to grasp, but have trouble saying to each other. It is true, I was already a searcher before the diagnosis of advanced cancer. Realities never seemed simple to me. I often looked beneath and saw layers and layers. Call it my writer's temperament or my having come from a home that was often erupting in anger and violence, I became an observer, a listener, a person who tried to figure out what was really going on. Now with the cancer mystery inside myself, I was trying to suss out what was going on inside of me, physically and emotionally, and what meaning I could possibly make of what life had brought my way. In short, always introspective, now I became even more intensely so. And to my astonishment, initially, I faced the new problem of a sudden and extreme impatience with fiction, with novels. I'd spent my life loving novels. Not long after my first diagnosis, though, I only wanted to read biographies and poetry. Novels just didn't seem serious enough to me anymore. I knew that a good novel can often tell more truths than nonfiction, as in Wolfe's Mrs. Dalloway, for example. And I also knew the delights of a story well told. But it was as if I was desperate for information about my own case, and at first, I had a hard time finding it in novels. Few really great English and American ones seemed to be about illness and fear of death, or about anyone over 40. I didn't feel interested just then in the struggles of young women or men to find the right relationship, or the coming of age of the artist, or even the political dilemmas of our time. I waited for this mood to pass while I devoured biographies and poetry, both of which I'd always loved, but now which became essential to me. This impatience with fiction, this inability to appreciate it, passed too, thank goodness. But it took some time. It strikes me that maybe I was angry at fiction, because although I'd always loved it passionately, especially 19th century English novels, think Dickens, George Eliot, Thomas Hardy, fiction had not been able to save me. Though my disappointment in fiction passed, and I am back to reading everything again, there still remains the problem of how complicated my reactions to life events are, and how embarrassed I often feel that I don't share simple reactions anymore. Here's a very personal case of the present moment. A joyous case, really, but a complicated one. My second oldest stepson just became a father. My husband and I now have our first local granddaughter. We have other grandchildren, but they live far away. So you'd think I'd be completely ecstatic, or at least that's what people have said, generously trying to share my joy. I do feel tremendous joy, and it is thrilling to watch my stepson be so happy. And it is indeed very sweet to hold a new granddaughter who comes, as the poet Wordsworth says, trailing clouds of glory. But because I know I am living in the late stages of a disease for which there is no cure, it is also bittersweet. I have one foot in the joy world and one foot in the world of fear and trepidation. Will I see our precious granddaughter grow up? Will I be well enough to help take care of her? Will I have the energy to joke and play and have fun with her as I did with my own children? How will I, energy-wise, manage being involved in her life while hanging on to my own? But the hardest part is not feeling good about talking about this other shadowy side, especially at a time when everyone else seems to be speaking the language of pure joy. A baby brings hope and the future, but for me, fear is there too, and a sense of my future's uncertainty. I struggle a lot with balancing hope and fear. Emily Dickinson's poem about hope has often haunted me. I tend to argue with it. Here's her gorgeous poem about how hope saves us without asking us much in return, and you all know this poem. Hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard, and sore must be the storm that could abash the little bird that kept so many warm. I've heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea, yet never in extremity it asked a crumb of me. And here's my answer to Dickinson in my own much less beautiful poem. My poem sees hope as asking an awful lot of us, as a danger because it is so intertwined with fear. Hope is no thing with feathers. Say rather, a moderate-sized earthquake that throws dishes to the floor, hurdles pictures off their hangings, an upsetting of one's delicate tree pose balance, the tree now become a crazy dog who barks at its own roots, or a raccoon in the garbage bins after midnight. Perhaps it's after the first shock of possible reprieve, she meant. Or maybe she was talking about love instead of death, or about her own writing. Then hope might just lift off land smoothly sometimes. Though fear remains the twin, disappointment the shadow. In any case, a wild fat bird not found in Sibley's plummets into my bedroom, sits on the exposed crossbeam, eyes me as I sleep, waits, then swoops down, down, down into my dream. I wrestle like Leda to hold on to my world, but thick feathers press me into the earth, hold me there, enough, and too much for me at the last. I have used my poems to express a lot of the complicated feelings I have that are so hard for me to talk about straight out because of my embarrassment about my own sense of alienation. And also because I know how quickly these feelings shift, their fluidity being always part of their story. Just when I think I know how I feel, in the next moment, I change. Poems let me capture these moments without getting frozen in them. So now we take a little shift, and I'd like to talk about advanced cancer and how it's influenced my teaching and my connection to my students. But there's a big perhaps here. I don't know really. I say perhaps because, as I mentioned at the beginning of this talk, I don't know if my perspective is a function of the cancer or of my age or of my sheer number of years in the profession. I suspect it's some combination. In any case, I want to read you another poem. This one I wrote about a character I adore in Our Mutual Friend, one of my favorite late Dickens novels. Her name is Jenny Wren, and she reminds me in odd ways of both myself and of my students. She's a doll's dressmaker, the young daughter of an abusive alcoholic father, and a person tiny in stature, misshapen both by birth and illness, and by her father's physical abuse. She lives at the very top of a tottering house, but she can look out from her attic room and see the rooftops of London. The line she repeats throughout the novel in a teasing, inviting way is, "Come up and be dead, come up and be dead." Very strange, I know. Very strange, very eccentric, very Dickens. A few years ago, I realized I identified with Jenny, her strange sense of humor, her industriousness, her difference from the traditional model of little girl, her illness, her determination to survive, her acknowledgement of death, her love of making doll clothes, which is her particular art form. I wrote this poem in her voice and in her honor. Baby in the poem is Jenny's name for her alcoholic father. Sloppy is her friend who will someday become her boyfriend. Jenny cannot do many things, but she does find her art working within her limits. Jenny Wren, the doll's dressmaker. It's all right to be crooked, one shoulder higher, one eyebrow singed, arms tilted in as if I'm always hugging myself, and so short I see under the table where people tap, tap, tap their feet, grip hands on their thighs. They don't look closely. Most think I'm a little girl who's lost something. I'm older than that, but I did lose my mother. I work at the very top of the house all alone, except for Baby, who's my father, who I have to scream at and punish because he drinks. London chimneys stretch out before me up there. Come up and be dead, come up and be dead. My friends think I'm odd, just a little. I wish you could see the outfit I made today. Skirt, purple satin, bodice, white lace, fine velvet jacket in black with gold braiding. The fancy little girl will love her, but only for a short time. She'll soon be one of many of her dolls. And besides, the fancy little girl has a real family and is getting almost too old for dolls. I will miss this doll and her outfit terribly, my purple satin girl. Only Sloppy understands it, maybe because Sloppy is an orphan and came from a workhouse. He towers up to see me sometimes and laughs until Baby curses and goes back to sleep. I don't know how to read or write, draw or paint or play the piano, but I know how to dress a doll. I know how to dress a doll. Jenny is peculiar and charming, different and struggling. She has a particular set of physical and emotional challenges and a complicated way of creating her world to accommodate them. She's determined, but also an outsider to the system. She does things in her own way, juggles the crazy demands of her own life. She is a true eccentric and a true charmer once you can see beyond her rough edges. Like many of our students, she has a specific set of personal strengths, some of which don't conventionally or so easily transfer to the academic world. She is a doll's dressmaker, after all, not a profession that most pursue. She is different. I think, for example, of the one or two students I have in my classes each semester who tell me they have some form of autism. They frequently have interesting and significant observations, but they can also throw the class off track, have trouble with organization, noise, and the social demands of small group work. Yet, they are often tenacious, well-meaning, intelligent, and sometimes very tender-hearted. And then there are the students who've developed expert survival skills outside the world of school. The one who lives on a houseboat, largely of his own making, because his parents have thrown him out. Another who lives out of his car. The mother with two children who goes from shelter to shelter, but somehow still shows up for class. Falling off the edge of the normal world, or holding onto it just minimally myself, gave me a new feeling of kinship with these students, with the Jennies, and a new appreciation of how it is to perceive oneself as so limited in certain realms while somehow managing a challenging life so different from the lives of many around one. But it isn't only the more unconventional students that my experience of advanced cancer, of imperfection and limits, has made me feel a greater kinship with. I find myself more and more interested in the inner lives of all my students, all that they do not say, all that they are thinking while the classroom conversation is buzzing around them. I find myself listening more deeply to them and encouraging them to listen more deeply to each other. This semester, I began starting each freshman English class with free writing, 10 minutes of private, unstructured writing, a chance for the brain and heart to empty out. I find this creates a kind of quiet and focus over the rest of the class because it gives students some time to catch up with themselves, which in turn gives them the ability to listen better to others. In my literature classes, I try to ask my students what a particular theme or character or plot turn means to them personally, what connections they see to their own lives. And I attempt to really make time for this discussion instead of it just being a kind of add-on to the day's lesson. I don't always succeed, as you might guess, And I'm sure that sometimes my students are impatient with my listening and giving space for them to listen to each other, wanting me to just get on with it. Part of the reason for my slowing down in the classroom, my making more time for talking, personal connection to the material, and listening to each other, is connected to a new sense of time that I have. Instead of seeing time as a linear production, a sense that we must always be going somewhere, I now see it more as an ocean we are all swimming around in, the past, present, and future, right there with us, always. But it is the present that has become most important to me, the present moment, or present hour and 20 minutes, the time for most of my classes. Each class session has become its own thing for me, and its pauses and silences as important as its busy talking. I have gotten a little better at waiting out my students, letting silence sit, allowing more thinking time in a discussion. I find myself spending more time on less, assigning fewer readings, but trying to go more deeply into each one. Kindness, connection, and effort have become more and more important to me as a teacher. And I appreciate the students who steadfastly show up to be part of our classroom community. Showing up is 90% of life, I tell my classes, quoting writer and film director Woody Allen. I mean it, but by showing up, I don't just mean bringing a body into space. I also mean bringing the mind and the heart. Oddly, I have become, I think, both a more forgiving teacher, identifying with how hard it is sometimes to do the demanded normal thing, but also a more demanding one. I now afford my students more chances to succeed, more do-overs, but I am also less tolerant of those who don't try. My own experience has taught me that sometimes showing up is the hardest thing of all to do. There have been days when my fatigue, headaches, and nausea and intense feelings of discouragement have made it hard to get myself out of bed, dressed, packed up, and into the car. But once on the road to DVC, I begin to feel better, physically and emotionally. I notice the trees along Highway 24, the hills of Briony's Park and Pleasant Hill Road, and look forward to seeing my students and my colleagues. This is what I do, I say to myself. I teach. And mostly, once on campus, I forget about cancer, survival statistics, medications, and doctor's appointments. I am just my teaching, thinking, professional self, doing my job, feeling competent, whole, my identity and place. Once on campus, I am not a cancer patient anymore. I am simply a professor trying to do my work. This connection to my work has helped me immeasurably, the sense of going on, doing what I do, and of living a meaningful life. Yet my experience with cancer has challenged the line between my professional and personal lives. I had always thought about how personal to be with my students, but the question of boundaries seemed easier when I was younger. As I got older, I felt more protective of my own privacy and of my family's. And I become more aware of how teachers need to beware opening up emotional areas for students that they really can't help them deal with. But for one thing, there was my headgear, my hats, my wraps. It was clear to many of my students that something was up, and sometimes they would ask me. My rule became not to announce my cancer treatment to the whole class, but to be honest if asked a direct question. Sometimes, though, I had to say something to the group. This semester, for example, when I needed to spend a certain amount of time each month in the hospital, and so had a wonderful colleague regularly substitute for me, a kind of team teacher. In fact, a kind of team atmosphere developed in all my classes that semester. My students knew I was struggling physically, but keeping up my part of our student-teacher agreement. We all seemed to pull together, and with one or two glitches, the sense of community made up for any problems in the team teaching arrangement. Sometimes students tell me their own cancer stories. Mostly they are stories about parents and grandparents, but sometimes they are about themselves or about friends. Over the years, a number of students have told me they've purposely taken my class because they heard I was an advanced cancer survivor. On the other hand, one student said she dropped my class because her mother was undergoing cancer treatment and my head wraps and hats were a too constant reminder. Other students say they find my energy for teaching while undergoing treatment inspiring. Some add, well, they figure if I can get up and come to class each day, they can too. I love that. But mostly because I am so obviously dealing with something hard, some students, I feel, tell me the hard things of their own lives that they might not share otherwise. My obvious vulnerability perhaps puts them at ease, makes me more human, less intimidating, and easier to approach. This is in part why I hardly ever wear my wigs. I usually feel funny in them, covered up, pretending that I am less damaged, less fragile than I really am. And yet, every once in a while, it does feel good to come in disguise, to look younger, more whole, more in control. Still, I usually feel more connected when not disguising my own loss. For so many of our students deal with terrible losses in their own lives. Those of us who teach writing learn about this through what they choose to write about and what angles they take on assigned subjects. Many students attend community college because their lives have been interrupted by losses of all kinds. Deaths in the family, drug or alcohol addictions, illnesses, divorces, financial setbacks or limitations, geographic or political dislocations, estrangements, war, prison. The interrupted lives of our students was one of the first features I noticed over 20 years ago when I moved from teaching at a four-year college. I was at first stunned by the stories of loss, lives broken and in the process of being rebuilt. Over the years, I've been equally taken by the stories of resilience, strength, persistence, and determination. Because I believe that at least in part, resilience and stamina come from a sense of life being meaningful, I find more and more that I want to help my students to access a sense of their own significance in the world. I think this will help to keep them in school, keep them persisting through hard times, and keep them sane when life sometimes seems arbitrary, terrifying, filled with limitations. In the 60s, we used to call a version of this wanting education to be relevant. That's close, but not exactly what I mean. I see meaningfulness as a state of mind as much as an outside standard, and I think it can be created in many ways within individuals. It can come from a sense of deep personal interconnectedness with others, even those who are no longer living. It can come from a sense of creative expression, from a taking in of love or beauty, as well as from a sense of one's specific contributions to the world. In this, the finding of meaning in love, in work, and in beauty, I agree with Viktor Frankl, the psychologist who wrote a book called, not surprisingly, Man's Search for Meaning. In a recent article in Psychology Today on the New Survivors, Wendy Paris tells us that psychologists conclude that apart from many other factors that help people live well with advanced cancer, the sense of meaning and life purpose is particularly important. I try to transfer this to my students. I'm not always successful, but I try. I try to help them to a sense of meaning in the assignments I give, the questions I ask, and the comments I make about what we read together. I can't even know a tiny part of what my students are struggling with, really. And even those who don't seem to struggle usually do. I cannot know what worlds each faces at home, what pasts haunt their families, what pressures they come to me with. But I try to open up a space for them to connect somehow, to themselves, to the readings, to me, to each other. For my life has taught me that often connection leads to a sense of meaning and purpose. And now the very last part of my talk, we're almost done. I want to shift to talking about how I've tried to make meaning of the cancer in my own life. And I don't have any great answers here, you'll see. Just more questions. Amidst what I see as the arbitrariness of a bad gene mutation, I happen to have the BRCA1 mutation, I can't really make much sense of it, except to understand that people get diseases. That's life. There's a randomness to it, as there is to many losses we all experience. I can't make much meaning out of that fact. I can't make much of the fact that I got a bad cancer. What I can do, though, is use it, which is what I've always tried to do. Ever the conscientious student, I've tried to learn from it. One thing I've learned is the importance of authentic presence, my own and others. To quote Edgar at the end of King Lear, I try hard to speak what I feel, not what I ought to say. I have found that the simple but honest presence of those around me and a sense of my own real presence takes the edge off the loneliness of living with my disease. I love it when people are honest with me about what they're really feeling, and I love to be honest. But it's not always easy and not always possible, depending on the social or professional circumstances. Even being present to myself is not always so easy. And I also understand that we are all often distracted, preoccupied, rushing, not always connected really to the moment we are in together. All of our lives make so many demands on us at any given time. I believe deeply, though, in the effort to be here with each other in a genuine way. I find it worth any awkwardness and anxiety it may cause, and it does cause some. Another lesson of living with an advanced cancer is that I usually am aware of the reality of finiteness. I live each day knowing that these days will not last forever. I mean really knowing, body knowing, not abstract intellectual knowing. I know, for example, that even if I feel relatively well today and this treatment is working, I may not feel well tomorrow and the next treatment may be a terribly hard one. There have been many of those. And that it may not work. In other words, I imagine my own death. I don't do it in a morbid way that makes me stop living fully, not usually anyway. It's more like those Renaissance folks who lived with a skull on their desks to remind them. You see those skulls in paintings from the period. I used to think they were strange, surreal. Now they seem normal to me. Oh yes, I think, there's death waiting. Sometimes I feel a great loneliness with this perspective. It's not the sort of thing you say at dinner parties, after all. But other times I find myself reaching out because I am aware of how short it all really is, how brief our time here, even if we live to be 107. It goes quickly. This perspective makes me try to do what I do well. And it also makes me really enjoy my pleasures, my moments of celebration. They stay with me. Mostly in this country, we don't think about mortality. We almost don't believe in death. Not really. We are too busy discovering the new frontiers or inventing new technologies that will, could it be, finally conquer death altogether? That battle image again. But there is much to be gained by losing the denial and taking in the realities of time passing. For really, once you're past a certain age, it's uncertain out there. No matter how well I eat, how much I exercise, how good or bad my gene pool, illness happens. Even death happens. In the English department, for example, Over the past several years, we lost two wonderful colleagues, both too shockingly young, both still filled with promise, gifts to share, both healthy until they suddenly were not. What good is remembering that? What good is shedding the denial about our own vulnerability? Denial of death is a powerful thing we all want to forget. But by remembering, I have found, I actually feel more alive. It's not just that I can appreciate life more, but also that I can inhabit it more, value each connection more, and go for depth in all things I care about. Cancer has taught me this, but so have literature, music, and art. I don't think my struggle with cancer is anything extraordinary. We all get a set of difficulties in life, and this has been my particular set. It has taught me how to know my limits and to not experience them as failure, but instead as the frame within which I can develop my strengths. I have actually come to value my strengths more because of the cancer, but it's a much more realistic valuing than I did earlier in my life, tempered by realities over which I don't have much control. Losing a control fantasy has been good for me, as has been slowing down, way down. And now I want to end my talk by telling you a very short story about a student I had many, many years ago. I was 25 or so and teaching freshman English at Berkeley. I had a student who I particularly adored, a young Vietnamese man who struggled all semester to do well in my class. He was extremely smart and thoughtful and a dedicated reader, but his writing skills were very problematic, really, really problematic. He handed in a last paper that was perfect. I knew in less than a second that he had plagiarized it. I asked him about it in office hours, and he confessed immediately. Then he began to cry. Then, after he gathered himself, he told me the story of his escape from Vietnam, his experience in a boat with smugglers who threw his father overboard, and his determination to do well in America, both for his father's memory's sake and for his own sake. He was honest about feeling desperate, worried that he would not have passed the class without the help of the plagiarized essay. Now, confronted by me, he felt terrible shame and terrible regret. He understood that I felt it personally, that I had had a special place in my heart for him all semester. Now he feared not just that I would report him to the dean, but also that I would never respect or like him again. He feared he had irreparably broken something in our teacher-student relationship. That was about 35 years ago, but I still remember him. Small of stature, round face, bright eyes, an older, serious person's face, though he was only 20. I gave him a do-over. I never reported him to the dean. I believed, and I still believe, that he would never cheat again. I have no idea if this is true, but I believe it. I remember it as one of the richest moments of my teaching career. Not because I necessarily made the right decision, but because we were both so honest in that moment. He about how he felt, and I about how I felt. Something good that I cannot find words for came of that, I am certain. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.